Good morning and welcome to Second Presbyterian Church on this warm 4th of July. If you've not received your vaccination, we ask you to mask up. Otherwise, you're welcome to remain as you are. We have the same worship service that we did 17 months ago. Today we'll be using our pew Bibles and hymnals. With one exception, a passing of the peace, we're still nodding to each other or waving or bowing to each other. Since the service is being recorded for an online audience, we ask you to remain in your pews until the postlude is concluded. You are here for a reason this morning, and so let us join together in our worship of God. Let us stand to worship God. It is God, our Maker, who sets us free to live. Jesus, our Christ, has blazed the trail of new life.
He goes before us to overcome sin and death.
It is the Spirit of peace that binds us as one. Glory be to God, our Maker, Christ, our Redeemer, the Holy Spirit of God.
Let us praise God, from whom all blessings flow.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Please join me in our prayer of confession. God of all creation, you are the designer of beauty and goodness. You call us to work for the preservation of beauty and the increase of justice. We confess that we see war between nations and we are afraid. We see conflict between ideologies and groups and resist engagement. We see opportunities for reconciliation, yet stand back, weary of the struggle. Forgive us and grant us courage. Give us hope in our despair. Give us a fresh sense of your holy purposes at work in our world, that we may be agents of healing all brokenness and agents of peace in all strife. Amen. Please take a moment for silent confession. Sisters and brothers, for freedom, Christ has set us free.
Do not use your freedom as an opportunity for self-indulgence.
Through love, serve one another. The whole law is summed up in one commandment.
You shall love your neighbor as yourself.
Bear one another's burdens. Please join me in the prayer. For Christ has died for us that we might have life and have it more abundantly.
Jesus Christ lives. He has become our peace, the cornerstone and head of the church.
The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Please be seated. Please join me now in our prayer of illumination. Holy God, author of all wisdom, we come to your word with gratitude and humility. Grant us openness of mind to listen with new understanding. Grant us sensitivity of heart to receive what we hear. Grant us willingness of spirit to live our response daily. Amen. Our first scripture lesson is from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 4, verses 14 through 21. Hear the word of God. Then Jesus, filled with the power of the Spirit, returned to Galilee, and a report about him spread through all the surrounding country. He began to teach in their synagogues and was praised by everyone. When he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring the good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. And he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. Then he began to say to them, "Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." The word of God for the people of God.
Our second scripture reading is from Luke's Gospel, chapter 4, reading from verses 22 through 30. All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his mouth. They said, "Is not this Joseph's son?" He said to them, "Doubtless you will quote to me this proverb, 'A doctor, cure yourself,' and you will say, 'Do here also in your hometown the things that we have heard you did in Capernaum.' And he said, 'Truly I tell you, no prophet is accepted in the prophet's hometown. But the truth is, there were many widows in Israel in the time of Elijah, when the heaven was shut up 3 years and 6 months, and there was a severe famine over all the land. Yet Elijah was sent to none of them except to the widow at Zarephath in Sidon. There were also many lepers in Israel in the time of the prophet Elisha, and none of them was cleansed except Naaman the Syrian.' When they heard this, all the synagogue were filled with rage. They got up, drove him out of the town, and led him to the brow of the hill on which their town was built, so that they might hurl him off the cliff. But he passed through the midst of them and went on his way." The word of God to the people of God.
Thank you.
When Jesus came home to Nazareth, he was invited by the rabbi to present his first sermon. As Jesus stood to read the Haftorah lesson, people marveled at his gracious words. "Wasn't this Joseph's son, one of our hometown boys?" But when Jesus sat down to interpret the text, his teaching started to agitate the people in the pews. His understanding of Scripture began to cause alarm because he mentioned how God had chosen a non-Jew from Sidon to end the drought, and how God had chosen a Syrian leper over all the other lepers in Jesus to dispense cleansing. This was not an incidental exception, but regular occurrences. And in that moment, the people of Nazareth began to see that Jesus was challenging their sacred cows. His new interpretation questioned their tribalism and challenged their nationalism. Their sense of being exceptional as God's chosen people was being negated, which made them angry. They were ready to take him up to the top of the pinnacle and throw him down and murder him. The Nazarites read the scripture as God's exclusive covenant with them, deliverance from their oppressors. But Jesus came announcing deliverance for all people. Not a national deliverance, but the promise of liberation for the poor and the oppressed, regardless of nationality, gender, and race. It was this radically inclusive message of Jesus that made them turn inward and circle the wagons, because their commitment to their own community boundaries took precedence over the prophet's message. 20 years earlier, Rabbi Hillel asked, "If I'm not for myself, who will be? But if I'm only for myself, what am I? If not now, when?" It seems there are two tensions within Judaism. The first involves the call to bear witness to each other, to lift each other up, to surround and support each other on the journey of faith. As a people, God chose them and gave the people their identity, their covenant, their heritage, and later a homeland. They needed to turn inward to strengthen their community. But at the same time, there is a deep strand of universalism to which the religion of Judaism bears witness. Isaiah tells the Israelite people that they're to be a light to all the nations, a righteous standard so that all people may believe in the God they worship. Their religion is to bless aliens and strangers within their borders and bless neighboring countries all around them. When religion turns itself outward, it works for the redemption and healing of the world. I think that's something important for us all to learn, that difficult and complex journey of balancing inward looking with outward looking, learning to be for ourselves as a church and a community of faith, but also learning to be for the liberation and emancipation of others in the world. In God's kingdom, us and them is always being broken down. God's grace is never subject to the limitations and boundaries of nation and group or race. Those who exclude themselves, others, those who exclude others, thereby exclude themselves. Human beings are instruments of God's grace, and we're never free to set limits on who may receive that grace and who may become an instrument of that grace. We're called not just to be open to persons that are different than us. We're called to believe and trust that the same God we worship is actively at work in another person's life and faith. While we affirm the primacy of our Christian faith for us, we also affirm God is a universal God, who works through Jews and Muslims, through Sunni and Shiite, through Sufis and Sheikhs. God works through Buddhists and Taoists. God can even work through atheists and agnostics. Archbishop Desmond Tutu said, God is not a Christian God. God's not a Jewish or Muslim or Hindu God. God is God. God is God. So that means whenever God brings us to a border or a boundary, get ready to have it broken down, right? Or whenever God brings us up against a barrier, get ready to have it dissolved. And how do we know this is true? We know it through prayer. Prayer is a window to the world. Prayer allows us to connect to God, who's connecting us to others. Whenever we pray, we first have to affirm the name and character and heart of the God we worship, a global and universal God. And then when we pray, we let go of our limited identities and pray for everyone all over the world. When you pray for someone different from you or a situation beyond your own, you can't help but be converted. Prayer expands our heart to know that God is at work within other hearts. And perhaps that's why we're at such a stuck place in our national life. We're in a period of arrested development, unable to go. Many politicians have learned that there are rewards in using the rhetoric of outrage and anger, because it's a powerful tool that can reinforce traditional identities and reinforce familiar boundaries. Politicians have learned that you can divide and conquer with fake news and interpretation biases and echo chambers, and everyone will remain reactive and defensive. But Jesus will have none of it. A relationship with Jesus compels us to be taken out of our cliques and removed from our comfort zones in order to let God be God, to experience God connecting us and joining us together in the work of redemption and healing a broken world. As we learn to overcome historic prejudices and cultural barriers, we learn to include and integrate and lift up all who have fallen and all who are suffering, so that God builds a bridge through us. And the name of that bridge is love. We need a heart that's open to the world. We need a better kind of politics. We need moral energy focused on the common good. We need a spiritual awakening in order to become neighbors with each other and family to one another. When was the last time someone's interpretation of Scripture infuriated you or challenged you? The people at Nazareth demanded that Jesus produce a miracle like he did at Capernaum. Maybe in coming home to Nazareth, Jesus invites us to come home to a global and universal God and to experience the miracle of the life that he offers. We are one because Christ has made us one. We're one in God and one with all God's people all over the world, breaking down barriers, removing obstacles, setting us free to live in love. That's the prophetic call. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us affirm our historic faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Welcome to Second Presbyterian Church this morning. If you're visiting for the first time, we invite you to sign a blue card found in your pew and place it in the offering plate that we might have record of your attendance. We are a multicultural and diverse congregation. We invite you to join us again and again. For those who have prayer requests, please fill out the yellow registration prayer cards that we might walk with you and your family in prayer. In our prayers, we remember especially all who are undergoing treatments for cancer and holding each person, holding each family in prayerful support, hoping for every cure and healing that's possible. In our joys, we celebrate our seminarian, Brian Lewis, has two pieces of good news for us. Brian is going to continue on with us for another year or semester, and then Brian also was passed by the Chicago Presbytery and advanced to the candidacy stage as a potential minister. We're overjoyed. And please note on your way out, we're near completion of the Rose window, which is above the Cullerton Avenue door. The structural work is nearly finished, and special thanks to Nate Lilatius and Bill Tyre, who did the research and completed the architectural design. It's a thing of beauty that will last a long time. So let us continue our worship by offering ourselves to God. Oh no, now we have the prayers of the people, and then we'll have the offering. Oops.
Let us bow our heads in prayer. Gracious God, we come to you from many places. Some hearts are overflowed with joy and gratitude. Others are barely hanging on to hope and faith. For some, this is an ordinary morning, but for others, every step feels challenging. Meet us where we are and bind us to each other, that in the community of your love, we might discover our wholeness. May your spirit empower us to imitate you by receiving those who feel rejected and broken. We also ask your blessings on our work and our rest, in jobs that feed our soul and in jobs that do not satisfy, in volunteer service and routine, daily tasks, in long hours of caregiving, and in hours we do not know how to fill. Teach us to care for the earth on whose gifts we all depend. May the paths we walk be wide enough for all people, the homeless, prisoners, persons of all colors, and those dying of incurable diseases. We pray to you that our children may grow up strong and kind, and that families may be strengthened for the sake of each member. Today, we rejoice in the favor you have graciously given us. We thank you for the blessings of liberty and peace. Your people, industries, businesses, we all need you. come and breathe on us new life until the whole is covered with your glory as the waters cover the sea. We ask all this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Now let us receive our tithes, gifts, and offerings.
Sanctify peace.
Lord our God, you are the source of every good and perfect gift. We praise you and give you thanks for gifts too numerous to count, all from your personal love for us. Keep us ever thankful for the gift of freedom and liberty, for the challenge to live responsibly with others, and for the joy of serving your kingdom. Keep us pointed and faithful in your service, and give us hearts of love. And now prepare our minds and hearts as we receive your gift of love in these elements. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated.
Friends, this is the joyful feast of the people of God. From east and west, from north and south, all will come to sit at table in the household of God. This is the Lord's table. Our Savior invites all who trust in him to share in the feast. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
Holy God, we praise you for the creation of the universe and the wonder of your handiwork. We marvel at the variety of people created in your image and given breath by your spirit. As a diverse people, we come to you in celebrating of our global family. You have placed us in different places within different cultures, speaking many different languages. Yet, you have called us to be one in Jesus Christ. In Jesus Christ, you have made us one. Grant us grace to see each other with a vision that is beyond sight. Help us hear each other with a profound listening of the heart. Make our unity a strong witness to our faith in your goodness and our hope for a more just world for each and all. Therefore, with your people of all places and times, with the whole company of heaven, we proclaim your greatness and sing your praise to the angels.
God of glory, when the time was right, you showed us the full extent of your love and your provision for our every need by sending Jesus of Nazareth to live among us. Born of Mary, Jesus shares our life. Eating with sinners, he welcomes us. Teaching the disciples, he guides us. Dying on the cross, he rescues us from sin and death. Rising to immortality, he gives us new life. Ascending to the Father, he gives us his Holy Spirit. Great is the mystery of faith. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these your gifts of bread and wine, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and blood of Christ. By your Spirit, unite us with the living Christ and with all who are baptized in his name, that we may be one in ministry in every place. As this bread is Christ's body for us, send us out to be the body of Christ in the world. As this cup is Christ's sacrificial love, help us offer ourselves in love for the redemption of the world. Continue to make us one church in one mission, celebrating our unity and united in our diversity, so that our ministry might reflect your oneness with all creation. Give us strength to serve you faithfully until the promised day of resurrection, when, with all the redeemed of all the ages, we will feast with you at your table in glory. Through him, with him, in him, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty God, one God forever. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord took the bread and blessed it and broke it and said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Take and eat in remembrance of me." We who are many are made one through his broken body for us. Take and eat the bread. In the same manner, our Lord took the cup and blessed it and said, "This is my blood shed for the forgiveness of sins. Drink ye all of it in remembrance of me." By his suffering, his love is poured out so that we might love the world as he loved us. The gifts of God for the people. Let us close with prayer. Lord God, as a people in history, you have set us in this time and place. Help us to become known as a people who live in love with others. Help our integrity to shine forth like light. Help us to believe that right makes might, that goodness will overcome evil, and that being a good neighbor can strengthen our life together. Make our church, our community, our city, our state, and nation to a good neighbor to our world, and guide us as your people that we might faithfully serve you as we serve the peace and justice of Jesus Christ. In his name we pray, amen.
Hallelujah.
Sisters and brothers in Christ, you are part of a great movement, a movement that began with the prophets and continued on through Jesus and the disciples and the apostles, a movement that continues through you and me and through our community. We are called to be emancipators and liberators and to do what we can in our time and place to open minds and hearts for love and justice. Go out into the world in the power of God's Holy Spirit and know that Jesus has gone before you and will go before you still. And may the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ hold us and give us courage. Amen.